genuinely, I'm slightly overwhelmed and surprised at the number of you who are here tonight. So I do appreciate you giving up your time on a Wednesday night to come to listen to my talk tonight. So key things I must mention about the fire exit is at the back. There's an exit here as well. More importantly, if you do need to leave rapidly to get to the bar, you can use those two facilities at the end. So there's a way out down there as well. So the presentation is, as the title suggests there, Sport and Exercise Science, how it's evolved, how it's been applied. And again, I'm trying to focus over the last 25 years. I'd like to briefly start with some acknowledgements and some thanks. So generally, thank you for coming. I'd like to thank, I say the usual, but my family, friends, more importantly, my colleagues who've probably allowed me the time and focus to dedicate towards the development of sport and exercise science and sport-related studies, not only in UIC, but externally as well. I'd like to thank Student Union for the do you're going to have afterwards, and the team, Karen, who's hidden already at the back, I think, and the guys who've supported me generally for tonight. So that's the genuine thanks that I'd like to put forward at the beginning. The title and who am I? That's the next part of the lecture, followed on by something to do with what sport and exercise science is, how it's changed, and how it's been modified over the last 25 years or so, to follow up by a bit on my journey. Sorry, guys, it's a little bit about me, but I like to think in one way it's difficult to differentiate between myself, sport and exercise science, sport, and UIC. I've actually been here on and off as a student and a member of staff for half of my life, okay? 24 years, if you count it. So I'm then going to end up with how I've used sports science and how sports science has been used nationally and at a very local level to enhance performance. So the one thing I would like to first engage is how many of you have been to an inaugural lecture before, professorial lecture? Big show of hands, please. Okay, excellent, about half the group. Okay, those who didn't put your hands up, just like to say, it's probably the best inaugural lecture you're ever going to have seen. So the other people who put their hands up will tell me about it in the bar later, I'm sure. In terms of why I was awarded the chair, it is slightly different. Those of you who put your hands up now, this won't be so much about my research. I have a research profile, but my chair was awarded for professional practice, the development in my discipline in sport and exercise science, both internally and externally in the UK. My chair was also awarded for the contributions I made to learning and teaching and curriculum development. And one of the other criteria is about academic leadership management at a local and a national level. So it will be a slightly different story I'm going to be portraying tonight. So one of the first questions to ask is 25 years ago. That's the criteria I set. Okay, who wasn't born 25 years ago? Hands up. There's a few straight. Okay, so some of you weren't even born 25 years ago. Okay, by the end of the session, I hope everybody's put their hand up for something. Okay, so where were you 25 years ago? What were you doing? Start looking at the other questions because I want some answers before we move on. Okay, who can answer any of those questions? Argentina, which one's that? Okay, that's the World Cup, excellent. You can modify the questions to suit, or the answers to suit the questions, okay. England or Wales? Rugby fans? England, 21-18. Ferguson, that could have been now or then, so that's the trick question. More importantly, or for tonight, it's not what you were doing, it's what I was doing 25 years ago. So, 25 years ago, this isn't me, this is Sid Aaron, MBE. The reason I put Sid up, he was the former head of department. He interviewed me in 83, and I transferred from Loughborough, slightly strange. I still think when he interviewed me, he thought I was doing sports science at Loughborough. I was actually doing engineering, okay? He offered me a place. I maybe didn't elaborate on the course I was on, and I ended up here doing sports science. Next round here, this is us young days winning the Bridge End Youth, and I stress Youth Sevens. I was very fortunate in 86 to go to the first World Cup in Rugby League and play for Great Britain. I also was fortunate enough here to have lost a few kilos, proudly wearing my, I hope, maroon and gold stripes. That's myself having 2 months vacation and working in Switzerland. My program director at the time, Dave Cobner, and some of the, shall we say, after activities that engaged in 86. What was I doing today in 1986? Today in 1986, 25 years ago, I was upstairs in A117 collecting data for my dissertation. This is cutting edge sports science. I was the only person allowed to use Professor Bell vouches the treadmill, the oxygen analyzer, and the high technology. I wanted to see what happened when you changed the weights of running shoes. And I wanted to look at energy expenditure, energy cost, oxygen cost. Rocket science this was in those days, okay? That's 100 grams of lead attached to the front of the shoe. Is a, what shoe is it?
Silver Shadow.
Silver Shadow, excellent, remember those? Okay. This is the high technology. This is the gas meter that measured the volume of air. This is the latest state-of-the-art equipment for measuring oxygen and carbon dioxide. And this is Martin John, my best man and one of my subjects. And that was the state-of-the-art treadmill. That's 25 years ago, hard to believe. Okay, first a couple of quick introductions about myself. I do know most of you in the room, I think, and I do think you know me in different shapes and forms. What do you do when you go to a lecture? You go to a lecture, you're not sure who they are, you Google a person maybe. So there we go, maybe I just wanted to Google myself. I Google myself, who comes up? Professor Richard Tong. Quite pleased, first out of 33 million. Not bad hits. Okay, next. The other thing for a bit of advice for guys, when you post a picture on the web, you always post one of you 5 to 10 years younger than you were at the time, right? And then remember it stays there for 10 to 20 years. The other ones are not me. I'm not the famous actor, Hollywood actor. I'm not the fashion designer, and I'm definitely not the DIY specialist here. I tell the students, the last lecture I gave in this room, Hannah was in the class and I was doing something on dissertations, refine your search. So one of the good things, I can put Professor Richard Tong in Google. Quite nicely, I come up as the first four hits. So I was quite pleased with myself. Very briefly, it's a little bit about me today. I apologise slightly, but I want to use this slide just to emphasise that there it is, that same picture. It just keeps popping up everywhere. But more importantly, I have some qualifications in sport and exercise science. Here, I have some academic leadership. And in particular tonight, I'd like to thank the MSc Sport and Exercise students who are here. And that course has been running for 10 years here, very successfully. You're the best qualified students we've ever had. You're registered GMC or you're chartered physios. So you're a great bunch of students to work with. And it's really brought sports science on here because we've had opportunities to interact and engage with you in different research projects. So, this is the part that all the students dread. Remember this, Hannah, last time we were in here, kind of get together. Right, if this were a taught session or taught module, I only use about 10 slides an hour now, okay, when I'm actually teaching. Tonight, it's slightly different. I kind of apologize, too many photos and other things. But in a session normally, I'm gonna now ask you to write down what sport and exercise science is. I like you to get into little groups with your notelets, post-its, refine it. Try to come up with an example of it, evolution, application, how have you used it. Create a question, each, combine those, one person in the group to ask the question, and then set you some research and follow up. That's what the students always go, we're not going to do that tonight, fortunately. But actually, once they start doing it, you can't stop them. Okay, so lecturing is not really about standing here at the lectern delivering in this way. So that's not the session. The main part of the lecture now. What is sport and exercise science and how has it evolved in the last 25 years? Google. I was getting excited, so I Googled myself. I Googled sport and exercise scientists. Guess what? These guys came up on the front page. So colleagues, Dr. Richard Neal, Dr. Ian Bazodis, Dr. Ian Mitchell, Stanny. Anyone know these guys up here? This is Professor Greg White with David Walliams, sports scientist, probably the most high-profile sports scientist in the UK. This guy here? Gavin, that's Gavin, isn't it? Anyone unsure on this one? Bruce Davis, Professor Bruce Davis. So they're the sign of this is sport and exercise scientists as portrayed to the world, okay? What is sport and exercise science? Sport and exercise science is about promotion and enhancement of performance or sport and exercise, and is comprised of a variety of disciplines, primarily physiology, biomechanics, psychology, performance analysis. I'm going to just talk you through each of those areas. The other thing about preparing for a lecture, it's always interesting because I've got quite an interesting diverse population, shall we say, from 10 years to 85, from people who are involved in sport and exercise science to people who have just come in because they think it sounded interesting, to others who have to be here. So quite an interesting group, so bear with me. Physiology may be the most important. That's my area of sport and exercise science. This is what physiology was like. It hasn't changed. It's basically the biology of sport and exercise science. So here we've got some examples, and again, cutting edge stuff this was. You had to be fit to be one of my technicians, okay? Mike Ball probably couldn't stay with this, that's why he had to move to a different area. But this is Trevor Dobbins. This is hand grip, this is measuring his grip strength. We thought this was cutting edge science at the time. Okay, hydrostatic weighing for body composition. We've got the multi-stage shuttle run test as a predictor of endurance performance. Hands up who's done the shuttle run test sometime. There we go, pretty good. So hands are all going up slowly. Come on, Danny, don't be shy. Your slide's on next, okay? Then we've got here, we've got a version of Trevor without one photoelectric cell. I must stress, he had to run all the way around and capture himself again. And then we thought we'd improve things in terms of standardization of technique, and we timed the sit-ups to a bleep. So that was cutting edge 20 plus years ago. Where are we now? Danny, you're glad you arrived. This is an example of cutting edge technology nowadays. A 12-lead ECG monitoring cardiac cycle changes, a mask monitoring oxygen uptake and endurance performance. We have the opportunity here, these are all colleagues in the lab, working to monitor the structure and function of the heart and how it changes during exercise and at rest, measure the size of the heart, and look at how it's being how it's changing during exercise. We've upgraded nowadays, it's called the BOD pod. It's a way of predicting body composition through changes in pressures. Ways of measuring strength, again, any section of the joint can be measured through isokinetic dynamometry here nowadays, and the latest hand grip dynamometer, which doesn't tell you just the strength, it tells you the EMG activity, the activity of the different muscles that's available or being used in those situations. So that's one of the first sports sciences. Next, nutrition fits under physiology. So I've just snuck this one in. This is what it was like 25 years ago. I used to work with these guys. Anyone help me out?
Tony Copsey,
Phil Davis, Rupert Moon. Okay, this is on the way back from winning the Sweps Cup final with the Scarlets, or Lethley as they were in the early 90s. And we knew that it was important. Carbohydrates, they're an important glycogen. As you exercise, they deplete. We knew about carbohydrate loading, and this is their version of carbohydrate loading in McDonald's. So that was 20 plus years ago. This is now the modern Big Mac that you're probably coming across, ergogenic aids, supplements, dietary interventions that are available. And here, this is just an array of drinks that claim, and I say claim in certain ways, to be able to enhance performance or allow you to exercise for longer. A lot of this is actually basic physiology, nutrition, that was around a few years ago. It's moved on in certain formats, in certain ways. Biomechanics. Now, Lynn. Unfortunately, Lynn wasn't in class that day, okay, when 25 years ago we were looking at the physics of sport. So physics, the biomechanics of sport, how we can actually measure and change things and how you interact with equipment and apparatus. So here we have a version, and this is generally what we would do. Take a series of still photographs, put them together, use a little bit of trigonometry. Anyone who went to school? That's why we do trigonometry, kids. Okay, to calculate some angles, to measure the velocity, and to measure or predict displacement. So the basic principles were all there, okay? Here, Mr. Webb, one of our former members of staff here, who taught everything from biomechanics to ethics. This is him teaching me how to play golf, and if you've seen Clive play golf, that's quite interesting. This is advanced biomechanics in those days, drawing on the computer screen to show some angles of some angles and some forces that are apparent. What happens nowadays? This is biomechanics today. Biomechanics today. Colleagues in the Sesame projects, the biomechanists in the room today, have interfaced technology into the shoe. This weighs 13 grams, and believe you and me, that can measure just about everything. Okay, through wireless technology, there's the opportunity to measure force, acceleration, displacement. All of these are fed through to computerized software, and real-time data is collected and given to the coach. So that's the important thing about real-time. In the bottom, here's some systems. Again, that's the more advanced use of sports science for analyzing performance. In this brief clip, you will hopefully see motion capture. This is biomechanics. This is a 1 minute video prepared for ISBS this year. This is about calibrating equipment. So the biomechanist in the front of this clip here is calibrating. There's cameras around the top of the setup here and on this side. He has a measurement tool in his hand. He's swinging it around and the reflectors are sending information to the camera. The next slide shows the athlete with reflector markers on her. This is now real-time world-class long jump in action. So to start with, maybe just slowing down the activity. That will give the opportunity for the coach, look at the reflective markers, to actually get a good image of what's occurring. So that's a slow-mo, that's just video analysis, which is a development that's being useful for sport and exercise science. What they do though is we collect and analyze that data. Okay, so it's now modeled. Okay, not the best image, but there's an image there of the model of the athlete. We can see the athlete interacting with the force platform and landing. The other thing, we can revert it, and this is a front-on view of the images that are available. Here we have ground force reaction, we have center of mass, and the changes that can occur. All of this information can now be fed back to the coach, which is important, in terms of providing instant real-time feedback. Just so you don't doze off. Okay. Another area, performance analysis. Again, performance analysts in the room, I don't know if you're around in these days, but this was post-match analysis. You collect the data, the video would be taken home or into a dark room for a couple of weeks. There'd be lots of sheets of paper, 10 sheets of paper apparently, and you'd send the information that you analysed and coded to the coach 2 weeks after their next match. Okay? Nowadays, cutting edge technology, FireWire, instant feed through from the camera to the analysis package. It's all coded, wirelessly sent down to the coach on the sideline. The coach analyses the data and can modify their performance or tactics for a match. So that's the way that performance analysis has moved. So lots of changes in technology have helped out real time. Psychology, psychologists, always interested here. This quote here, psychology is to do with the mind. Okay, so it's all to do with the mind and the way that the mind changes, and it changes your behavior during stressful conditions or during exercise. So the evolution really came from Rainer Martens. Now, what it was suggested that psychologists used to wear their white coats. They used to be in a laboratory environment. They used to have lots of theories which are fundamentally sound, and they used to do lots of questionnaires and assessments. So there was Eysenck's personality test, Cattell's 16PF test, a whole range of tests that were done in the laboratory. So that was the smocks, the white coats. Jocks, those of you not familiar, that's a kind of crude term for sports students. So what they wanted to do is get it from the lab out into a real environment. So this is what's happened. Fortunately, Professor Sheldon Hanton, who's in the audience tonight, and colleagues here, have produced the latest review on sports psychology today. Basically, things like burnout, 25 years ago, no one had ever considered burnout in young athletes. Also, can you look at the topics and titles and think about maybe just applying those areas to the recent World Cup incident with Sam Warburton? So all of these areas, social support, motivation, coping strategies, stress, anxiety, The psychologists have moved a long way in terms of the sound principles are there, but they're now applying it in a setting that's potentially as close to performance as you can be. There's a psychologist at the World Cup in nearly every activity nowadays. The real world, this is what it's about now. So it's putting all of these together now. So what we did, and this is again old science, so these guys here, I worked with a chap called Peter Herbert, an MSc student in just when I arrived in the early 90s. And what we did is we collected data and we wanted to look at the work rate patterns of number eights and wingers during real life situations. And we wanted to use performance analysis, video analysis to track them as well. Now, again, the principles haven't changed very much, but this was the technology we were working with. The data is just an example. This graph took the data time to capture the 8 games for 10 athletes. It took us a whole season, okay? Literally now, what I'm trying to show in the middle here is the live real-time collection. This is an ice hockey match. They have a GPS system on them that monitors the movement patterns. They have a heart rate telemetry system built in that monitors the heart rate and energy expenditure and activity that's going on, and it's fed back live during the match. How things have evolved. So part of the theme today is about real time. People want it, they want it now. In the years preceding this, we could get you information as sports scientists, but it took quite a long time. The final one here, this is probably a good example of interdisciplinary, the real life situation. Scott Simpson, one of our international former students and members of staff, he's wired. If you look about psychology, mental preparation, biomechanics, looking at the reaction time of the sprint starts, and if you look at the structure and function of his body, the physiology that's been input into his training base, and the opportunity to get to this type of environment. The probes and electrodes, the data set, this is an example of data that can be collected during live situations. So it's moved quite a long way. What's happened in terms of academic developments? Now, sport and exercise science. I know my parents, I'm sure my dad's forgiven me from giving up being an engineer to become a sport and exercise scientist. It's evolved considerably. Sports science, mass participation, numbers of students on courses, the teaching delivery, the style, the facilities, QAA, imagine that in those days, QAA, benchmark statements, PDP, program specifications, transparency, transcripts. Okay, 25 years ago, you got a degree and that was it. What's happened now? Audit and evolution. Where did this all come from in terms of sport and exercise science? It started, as Dave mentioned earlier, the wing colleges. So it started in PE departments, and that's where it started here. Loughborough, Carnegie, St. Luke's. Next, the science faculties thought, well, there's money, there's students in sport and exercise science, let's start creating sport and exercise science degrees. So the science degrees were created with a high laboratory base, but little practical application. Then what happened? Leisure management departments, more students. So that really wasn't sports science in the leisure management areas, it was the sports studies. What's happened now? Would you believe you search UCAS? There's 2,000 variations of sports science courses, from alpine sports science to water sports science. Okay, there's a whole range of activities that are engaged, but they're linked with sport and exercise science. Evolution. Nationally, there's an association called British Association of Sport and Exercise Sciences now. Now, the British Association of Sport and Exercise Science was formed 30 years ago. Okay, it's the lead organisation for the development of sport and exercise science in the UK. The American College of Sport and American College of Sports Medicine. It's a huge organisation now. Now, these were in their infancy 20 to 25 years ago. How can we make sport academic? You know, we've been trying to justify that, a lot of us, for a long time. I actually think we're nearly there, and we possibly are there in several instances. Only yesterday came out on the, anyone who saw it, on the Research Wales website, 16 areas that there's some funding available for, and they're the STEM subjects, so science, technology, engineering and mathematics. Sport and exercise science is actually in there. So can you imagine 25 years ago somebody putting sport and exercise science next to medicine or mathematics or technology? So guys, I think we've really come a long way and it's really positive. So that's a little bit about academic developments. Technological developments, my first book, not quite, but if you understand, as a youngster, I had an interest in sport and an interest in science. I did double maths and physics at A level for some reason, and thought I could go to Loughborough and play rugby and have a good time as well. Okay, I decided that sports science was for me. The body actually hasn't changed much in terms of its structure or function. Okay, the books that support it have improved considerably. The resources, the World Wide Web now phenomenal in terms of getting pictures for your presentations, okay, or just researching information and supporting learning and teaching. So technological advances have been significant. Help me out, the older ones, okay. So, chalk. Anybody ever written on a blackboard? Put your hand up, please. Okay, we must be getting close to everyone having their hand up now, I hope. Okay, so you were innovative if you had coloured chalk, okay, and neat writing. You were even more lucky when whiteboards came along for teaching, sport and exercise science, teaching, delivery. Then you thought you'd made it, the overhead, okay? Even better than the overhead projector, what came along? Pre-prepared overheads that were distributed if you bought so many books. Wasn't lecturing great and easy? What happened then? Slide projector, big presentation tonight, slides. You go away, you take them, you generate them, you produce them, you put them in, you find out they're backwards or upside down. Okay, good memories in the room now. My first presentation in sport and exercise science, genuinely, was in this room in 1991. What happened here in 91? Basis conference. So I gave my first presentation in sport and exercise science 20 years ago in this very room. So things have moved on a little bit, maybe I haven't, okay? What's happened nowadays? Visualizer, excellent. Visualizer, those who are not familiar with it, is a very flashy overhead projector, basically, but the brilliant thing about it is you can put something on it and you can project it live. I could put my notes up here, project them live, I could give you a demonstration. Technology, the smartphone nowadays. That's going to be here, that's available soon. You'll have your iPad, you'll be displaying it straight onto the screen live and giving presentations like this. Unfortunately, this has crept in. And I do stress, possibly tonight as well, death by PowerPoint. People are more interested, I confess myself, I've spent more time putting these slides together than I have actually probably talking through them. I would like to have think that I could have done this lecture with just 10 slides. Okay, but I thought the pictures were funny and they kind of keep you amused a little bit. So PowerPoint, that's probably the death of higher education. One of the most worrying things probably nowadays as a lecturer is if you can lecture without PowerPoint presentation. So fortunately, I've got about 15 minutes left if you're timing me, anyone, and you want to know where we are. So I'm a reasonably experienced lecturer. I can hopefully go on for 15 more minutes without any slides. However, I did make one earlier, just in case. So the next stage, so we're kind of 2/3 of the way through the lecture now. How has sport and exercise science changed? We've done a little bit of that so far in the areas. And how have I changed? Now I must confess, it's quite difficult to separate myself, and this is a bit about me, I do apologise, but I've been here for 24 years on and off as a student and a member of staff. I kind of feel as though I am part of the school of sport in so many different ways. And I think a lot of you in the audience who are members of staff here really have an affinity for the school of sport. It is now the largest provider of sport-related subjects in the UK. So a little bit about the school of sport, and it's a little bit about myself to tell a little bit of a story here. 1986. Help me out. It's not just me hiding at the back here. Anybody? Mr. Cooper, who's a member of our staff. Mr. Treadwell, Mr. Webb, Mr. Power, who's in the audience tonight, might be Mike Wall even by chance, okay. But the other thing, more importantly, Dr. Paul Balsam, the sports scientist associated with Swedish football, you'll be pleased to hear, okay. Hugh Bevan, working with the English cricket, and a whole range as a head of department there from Staff University. A lot of sport and exercise science went on here under the guise of human movement studies. Have a look outside at those trees, 25 years on. Quite frightening. I moved from my time in sports science at UIC, Cardiff, South Morgan Institute, Cardiff Metropolitan, and I moved to Loughborough. I was lucky enough to meet this guy here. Anyone help me out? Professor Dave Kerwin interviewed me for my MSc at Loughborough. He was suitably impressed, amazingly as I thought, with my dissertation that I took with me on the energy cost of running shoes of different weights, and he kindly assisted in me getting a science and engineering research scholarship to attend a year at Loughborough. I became one of the lab rats when I was there. That's myself participating in a maximum oxygen uptake test. Just to show you guys, I have been there. This is a muscle biopsy being taken during a PhD study. So that was sports science again in the late 90s. I moved from there. Dave mentioned some of this earlier. Not the best slides. This guy here, one of my students in Brunel, Professor Greg White. Okay, he was a mature student, obviously, as you realise. But we were working with elite athletes. Okay, and we were doing testing with them there. Here we go. This guy here, Professor Peter Terry. Some of you probably remember him. We're doing some work here. Those of you old enough in the audience, Frank Bruno and I think it's Justin Fashionu. We're involved in lots of different applied sports science, as it was in those days. Briefly to show these individuals, John is heading up sports science now in Oxford Brookes University. This chap here, not the best photo, Fraser, very dear friend of mine. Fraser was a student there. He did a BSc in sport and exercise science. He modified and went and did an MSc. He then wanted to do medicine. What did he have to do? He went back and had to do two A levels in physics and chemistry to be eligible. He's now an orthopedic surgeon working out in Edinburgh. So sport and exercise science wasn't accepted in those days. Nowadays, you can get an accelerated program and you can integrate fairly quickly into medicine and other areas. Maybe we've made it. In the corner here, just want to put a picture of Paul up. Paul Grimshaw, probably one of my inspirations in terms of developing myself in sport and exercise scientist. He's in the University of Adelaide now, heading up sports biomechanics over there. What happened then? Okay, I left there, I came back, as Dave said. This is one of the second or third cohorts. Anybody in the audience recognise themselves? Who's this chap here? Daryl Cobner, okay, down the front here, Lucy Power, a few ex-students, Karen, I think your husband's there as well, Bob Blunt is in the audience. So these were sport and exercise science. What I'm trying to portray from here is the size. That was sport and exercise science in 1994, I think, or 95. This is sport and exercise science now, okay, that's an exam, physiology exam at the end of last semester. What have we got here? Hasn't grown that much, maybe. The lectures, that's a staff meeting, okay? That is one of our staff meetings. We have to hold them in the lecture theatres now. And again, this is the type of environment that students want to be in now. They really want to have technology, wired, live feed, etc. So things have moved quite a long way. A busy slide, but I just wanted to give you the size and scope of the evolution of sport and exercise science and sport-related subjects in the UK. This was my generation, BA Human Movement Studies. BSc Sport and Exercise Science validated 30 students. 32 were allowed in. That was the maximum number of students in the first few years. Next, key highlight. Year 2098, an MSc in Sport and Exercise Science. You didn't have to leave here to go to Loughborough or elsewhere to do further qualifications. What came along then? MSc in Sport and Exercise Medicine. And again, I must stress, there's a module that's going on this weekend in sport and exercise science on a medical program. Then our intercalated program. Most famous recent graduate, Jamie Roberts. And I have evidence from all of the medical students, not sure this year yet, that actually they find G genuinely the work they do here harder than medicine. They said harder, they said different as well. It's a different type of learning. And it's really been quite enlightening, actually, guys, how tough sport and exercise science is nowadays. What inspired me to become a sport and exercise scientist? Okay, a few things, just a few bullets here. Professor Bell. Bill, I must thank for supervising my PhD and starting me off on the road in exercise physiology. I was working with these guys at an elite level in the early 90s, and I was playing a little bit of rugby before that. I wasn't a very good rugby player, okay, but I was actually quite a fit rugby player, okay. And this is a good friend of mine who's a reader now, Dave Stenson in Loughborough. Dave was there when I did my MSc. We used to read articles, we used to talk about things. And what sorted me out and kind of started me on the way towards being a sport and exercise scientist was an article by Henrik Lackamy. So the younger members of the audience, is a few minutes on a little bit of research and advancement now. So Henrik designed or started to design a sprint treadmill that was able to be used to collect data in the laboratory. I read an article by Phil Jakeman, Joe Doust and Ed Winter, The Future Directions for Sport and Exercise Physiology. And it highlighted that there was an absence of the underpinning physiological mechanisms to do with multiple sprint sports and sport-specific tests. So what did I do? This is my PhD. Okay, so if you want to have a look around here, this is a load transducer measuring horizontal and vertical velocity. Guys, that was the first time it had ever been measured. Vertical force, not velocity. Okay, this is a way of interfacing and measuring speed on the treadmill. This is a program we put together and the highest technology to collect the data to analyze it. This is one of my fellow students at the time, possibly, I'm not sure, Gareth Irwin, one of the test guinea pigs, and here's the interface against the wall. So that was my PhD. That's probably where I was for 5 years in my life. The other thing, I don't think I particularly got it wrong, because that is what they're... Sorry, let me just show you here. This is a clip of high-intensity intermittent physiology. I would take measurements, gas, air, bloods, after they performed 10 of those with a 25-second recovery. I was a really popular member of staff for collecting students. But actually, if you look at my treadmill there that I put together and look at the one that's on sale in Cranley at the moment, actually wasn't that far away. Sport and exercise science has moved a long way, but the basic principles are fundamentally sound and were there in the early days. What else has evolved? The number of sport and exercise science related journals that are now available has increased significantly. These are just a few of them, and by chance I've published in these, but what I'm trying to show here is that what this is actually telling you is that there's been a fivefold increase in the number of sport and exercise science journals. And again, medics, I don't apologise, but mentioning sport and medicine in the same breath 25 years ago wasn't acceptable. A recent article here by Will Hopkins looking at impact factors. Now, impact factors are the number of times that an average journal article in a journal is cited. So the higher the number, they're saying, the more useful that information has been or the more it's been read. So, pleasingly, again, these are some of the core ones that I've been involved in with my colleagues here, but it's moved a long way, and the impact factors of sport and exercise science journals has increased phenomenally. The research assessment exercise. Okay. Now, this is what measures the quality and quantity of research that comes out of universities. It started in 96. There's been a significant increase in the number of universities that are putting forward for this, but also in the quality of it. Five of these universities received a five-star rating and did pretty well ourselves, because Cardiff Met didn't even exist. But as the Cardiff School of Sport, we came sixth. So that was a very positive advancement nationally and for the school in terms of research. A quick who's who and where we are. So what's the relationship between all of these universities and me? Board member at the back. Quality Assurance Agency. Excellent. Okay. So, again, I never thought I was one of the youngest QAA quality assurance reviewers in the UK, and I did the sport-related areas. However, I'd never been allowed to go, I would call it, to a real university. Okay. Eventually, made it to Warwick on their quality assessment audit. So, it's not myself, but it's sport and exercise science has been accepted as an equal academic discipline. Next one here, relationship again. These are all universities that, as Dave mentioned earlier, that I've been involved in, or we've had involvement in validation, external examinership, and other sports-related developments. And again, if you look in the middle, Exeter, Aberystwyth, the traditional kind of red brick universities that traditionally wouldn't have had sport and exercise science with them. I'd like to just pause for a moment, and this is for my colleagues, this slide. So my colleagues are very good at reading very quickly. So can they just do a quick read through the quote? Those of you who are kind of just thinking about the bar now, just chill out for 20 or 30 seconds. The statement I put there, I genuinely feel that was the opening line of my application for my National Teaching Fellowship. So I would genuinely like to thank all my colleagues who've helped me in the research, the teaching, and all of the developments since I've been here. Final part of the lecture, you'll probably be here pleased to hear. So how's it been applied at an elite level? I first arrived back here in 92, Barcelona Games. Barcelona Games Marathon, hot country, hilly. This is the height changes in the 26 miles of the marathon during the Barcelona Games. What we did is we put Steve Brace, the current number one Welsh athlete, on our treadmill in laboratory. We pre-programmed it, and we used sports science to primarily mimic the actual inclines and velocities that he'd be running during the Barcelona Olympics. Okay, so that was using sports science in a very applied setting. Next paper here. Same treadmill, different person. Anyone recognise the guy in the back? Professor Andy Jones, good friend of mine, professor of sport and exercise physiology at Exeter. He produced a great paper. If you want to go away and read a paper, a general paper, go and have a look at this paper in Journal of Sports Med. It's on Paula Radcliffe for 5 years. So he collected a series of data on Paula. Here's his data. Just bear with me for a few moments, the non-physiologists and the physiologists possibly as well. This is Paula's data. This is her maximum oxygen uptake. So what actually happened in the 10 years that the data that we've got for Paula Radcliffe, her maximum oxygen uptake didn't really change that much. So why did she get so much better? Her running economy, that's the amount of oxygen that she needed to use to run a kilometre, it decreased by about 30 units over a 10-year period. So if you put that one there together with this one here, okay, she's capable of running at higher speeds for lower oxygen uptake or oxygen cost. Also here, the velocity at VO2 max that she could achieve. So the actual speed that she could achieve increased, you've been on the treadmill, increased 3 kilometres an hour over a 10-year period. Put those together with blood lactate measurements and concentrations, what you want to see here is the graph moving downwards possibly, but to the right. So if you look here, in the early days, she was reaching a threshold. And if you go above a certain threshold in your lactate concentration, fatigue will set in. So she was only capable of running at about 14 and a half kilometers an hour for a long duration. This marker here, after 10 years, that is 2 hours 15 marathon pace. So she managed to shift the graph to the right. And that was the physiological support of Professor Andy Jones and co. Personalising the data slightly. I also collected data on myself over 10 years. Okay, the graph points are slightly different. I finished in 2002. That was enough for me. Okay, if you notice here, not too bad. I was on the same graph as Paula, at least, moving from 60 down to about 55. What was happening in terms of my economy, okay, didn't really improve. wasn't even on the same graph as her. If you look in terms of velocity VO2 max, not even on the same page. And down here, my lactate threshold, okay, not even on the graph. So, I applied the data that I had on myself, and I put together a very quick training program, 3-month training program to run a marathon. I had a couple of drinks in the bar at the end of term, and we said we were going to run a marathon, myself and Jim, before we were 45 or something like that. So I wanted to apply some science. I had a lot of data on myself, and I collected a lot of data over the years. And I thought the easiest way of doing this is to use the heart rate monitor system. So I undertook a series of tests on myself in the laboratory, and I came up with my target heart rate for running the marathon. And I needed to be under about 167, 68 beats to be able to maintain the pace for the duration of the marathon to reach my target time. Now what happened? We set off. This is the first, it's a four-hour slot here. We set off here. Bit excited at the beginning of a run, everyone overexerts, bit of anxiety. We had to slow down a little bit, took the pace off, and ran through. What are these three little dips here? Toilet stops. Paula ran faster because she doesn't stop, if you remember. Okay, we had to stop three times briefly during the marathon, which kind of delayed us slightly. Sports science, I was applying it to the nearest second, I was hoping. What happened towards the end? There we go, gloves off, basically. I'd forgotten about 385 yards. I hadn't allowed for three toilet stops as well, so we had to run pretty fast for the last part of the race. Key thing is, here's Jim just behind me, hasten to add, at the finish. Here's the official time of 3:59:59. Sports science applied to the nearest second. I've also finally just like to add that the opportunity to apply some of the research that I've done and worked with personally. Here we go, some work that we did with aerobic fitness of children. Hopefully Molly and Rosie there have applied that in the field. Joe wasn't part of this study on muscle activation characteristics in gym routines, but it's a great photo, I thought, so I wanted to put it in. Ricky, my nephew, is a top 50 GB under 16 tennis player. In my younger days, I did a lot of work at Bisham Abbey with the LTA. And I'm even today, this is last summer, still trying to apply sports science to help me in performance. And we ended up this summer by chance running a quick duathlon aquathon on holiday. So I'd like to just conclude and leave things there. Hopefully I've shown you a little journey. I say a little journey, 25 years of the evolution of sport and exercise science. I've tried to show where it was, and actually that it was fundamentally pretty sound all those years ago. What we can do nowadays, we can do things now. We can do things in real time. We can collect and analyse data that would have taken us a year in a day. They're the advances in sport and exercise science. If there's a couple of take-home messages, another take-home message for the youngsters, those who weren't born before 1996, is try to combine your job with your hobby, okay, and your interest, because, boy, you're going to spend a lot of time in your job. On that side, I'd kind of like to apologise to my wife and extended family for possibly some of the time that I've spent in sport and exercise science over the years. I've tried to show you a little bit about what I was doing when I was late home for dinner, when I didn't come on the Sunday meal, or I didn't go on a particular outing. So those were some of the things that I was involved in over the last 25 years. I'd like to thank Emily, my wife, Rosie, Joe, Molly, my family, my extended family as well, my mum, my mother and father. I'd like to thank for all the support. Pam in particular, who's looked after my children for a good part of my academic career. And without those benefits, I wouldn't be here tonight. So a genuine thank you for giving up your time tonight. And more importantly, there are drinks in the bar, and I suggest we have some brief questions. And the most important thing, Joe needs to go to football training at 7 o'clock. So thanks for your attention, guys.